On the 1st of September 1939, Germany invaded Poland. Within 3 days, Britain, France, and their empires were at war with Hitler's Reich. Newspapers, newsreels, and radio commentators loudly proclaimed the beginning of the Second World War. Neutral nations reasserted their non-belligerence. Some, like Holland, Belgium and Luxembourg, wedged between the major belligerents, were armed as well as they could be and were prepared to fight for their neutrality. Others, like Denmark and the countries of the Scandinavian peninsula, Finland, Sweden and Norway, were sufficiently far from the likely fields of battle to hope that they might avoid being drawn into the conflict. Such hopes were to prove futile. Scandinavia was very important to both the USSR and Germany. The southeastern border of Finland was only 32 kilometers from Leningrad. If Finland could not convince the Soviet leader, Joseph Stalin, that she would never allow her territory to be used by Germany in an assault against the USSR, then it was likely that Stalin would take preemptive action. Ironically, Germany had not yet developed plans to attack the Soviet Union via Finland. What did concern Hitler, though, was the possibility that Britain and France would move against Norway in order to cut Germany's supplies of high-grade iron ore. This commodity, vital to Germany's war industries, was transported from the mines of northern Sweden via railway to the Norwegian port of Narvik, where it was shipped south along Norway's long and vulnerable coast. Hitler was not wrong in his apprehensions. Almost from the moment he entered the Admiralty on the 1st of September, the new First Lord, Winston Churchill, had been planning to do precisely this. So as Hitler and Stalin were dividing Poland, they and Winston Churchill were all looking north to Scandinavia. To most of the world in 1939, the Soviet Union appeared huge and threatening. In the east, large battles had already been fought between Soviet forces and the Japanese Kwantung Army along the borders of Manchuria and Mongolia. To the west, Nazi Germany was moving steadily eastwards. In the previous year, Hitler had absorbed Austria, the Sudetenland, Bohemia-Moravia, Slovakia, and was now making demands that Poland relinquish the Danzig corridor. For nearly 2 years, the USSR had been conducting low-level diplomatic conversations with Finland in attempts to reinforce guarantees of Finland's continuing neutrality. For its part, Finland had no desire to become a satellite of the Soviet Union and had looked first to her Scandinavian neighbours, particularly Sweden, for support in the event of a confrontation with the Soviet Union. When Russian pressure frightened Sweden off, Finland held discussions with Great Britain, and on the 18th of June 1939, General Sir Walter Kirk arrived on a four-day visit to Helsinki. A week after Kirk's visit, the chief of the Wehrmacht's General Staff, General Halder, arrived in Helsinki for an inspection of Finland's defences. News of Halder's visit to Helsinki reached Moscow on the 30th of June. On the same day, Stalin instructed Shaposhnikov, the chief of the Soviet Army's General Staff, to draw up a contingency plan for a war with Finland. For much of the summer of 1939, Moscow was gripped by the fear that Germany might launch an imminent attack through Finland. However, the signing of the Soviet-German Non-Aggression Pact on the 24th of August transformed the situation. Germany and the USSR, at least for a time, would make common cause. On the 1st of September, German forces struck deep into Poland, cutting off Polish army groups that had deployed too far forwards and rapidly closing in on Warsaw. On the 17th of September, Soviet armies rolled across Poland's eastern frontiers, and a few days later met German units at Brest-Litovsk. Stalin had the beginnings of a buffer against further German expansion, and he lost no time consolidating it. On the 22nd of September, Foreign Minister Molotov summoned the Prime Minister of Estonia to Moscow, an invitation that was extended to Latvia and Lithuania in the first week of October. The result was that each of these countries entered into mutual assistance treaties with the USSR, which were tantamount to their absorption into the Soviet Empire. A similar summons went to Helsinki on the 5th of October. The Soviet Union demanded that Finland cede islands in the Gulf of Finland, lease the peninsula of Hanko to the USSR, give up much of the Rybachi Peninsula on the Arctic coast, move the frontier in the Karelian Isthmus region westward to a point only 20 miles east of Viipuri, and destroy all existing fortifications on the isthmus. Given the disparity in power between Finland and the USSR, these terms appeared moderate, but to most Finns, they were the thin end of the wedge. When the final meeting took place, Stalin was in an almost jovial mood. He shook hands with every member of the Finnish delegation and wished them well. The Soviets were certain the forces they were assembling would, within a very short time, be dictating peace terms in Helsinki. In the autumn of 1939, Joseph Stalin was at the height of his powers. Since the death of Lenin in 1924, the party's membership secretary, once thought of as a colourless clerk, had systematically removed his real and potential enemies from the party's bureaucracy, while at the same time removing masses of class enemies like the kulaks. Since 1937, the Soviet Union had been reeling from his purges of the upper echelons of the Soviet army. By the summer of 1939, only one marshal survived, Zhukov, whose remote posting in the Soviet Far East may have saved his life. Virtually all generals had also disappeared. Indeed, it was only at the level of lieutenant colonel that an officer had more chance of surviving than not. The result of these purges was that Stalin was isolated. He depended on information fed to him by a network of subordinate agencies, more so than any contemporary leader. Terrified that they too would be purged, there was a natural tendency on the part of subordinates to tell Stalin what they supposed he wished to hear. The Russian embassy in Helsinki reported that Finland was paralyzed by class strife, and that the Finnish proletariat would rise up and welcome a Soviet army as liberators. Stalin then expected his armies to occupy Finland within a few days, in an operation rather like the occupation of the eastern part of Poland after the 17th of September. Looking southeast from Helsinki, Finland's most prominent soldier, Baron Carl Gustav Mannerheim, expected very much the same outcome. He had spent the autumn of 1939 pleading with the civilian government to take the Soviet demand seriously. But he still had no success. Mannerheim prepared to resign. He had no wish to be party to a policy that he was sure would cause the destruction of Finland. During the 1930s, the Soviet army had become fully mechanized and motorized. Maneuvers held in Kiev in the summer of 1935 and 1936 demonstrated to the world an awesome military power. Soviet forces, organized into tank and rifle armies, were configured to break open an enemy's front and then penetrate into the enemy's strategic depth. The concept, known as deep battle, had been the brainchild of a group of brilliant theorists who had gathered round Marshal Tukhachevsky. Unfortunately, Tukhachevsky and virtually all his lieutenants had been purged during the course of 1937, which left the Soviet army with an offensive doctrine that very few knew how to put into practice. To make matters worse, all Soviet units had commissars attached to them, political officers, whose job it was to supervise the ideological obedience of the military. There was no longer such a thing as a purely military decision. every action had to be countersigned by the Commissar. All Stalin's generals had been hugely impressed by the success of the German armoured offensive in Poland, which Western journalists were now calling a blitzkrieg. Stalin too wanted a blitzkrieg, in which Soviet armoured columns smashed into Finland. Finnish strategy depended on enhancing the natural defensive properties of the Finnish terrain with man-made fortifications. The border, 1,000 kilometres long, could be easily penetrated, but invaders would find their advance confined to the very few roads that ran through a wilderness of dense pine forests and a maze of lakes and rivers. So instead of being based on defeating the Russians, which was acknowledged to be impossible, Finnish planning relied on delaying them for long enough for sympathetic nations to intervene. The Finns believed major Soviet thrusts across the border from the north of Lake Ladoga to the Arctic were unlikely. Logistic problems alone seemed to rule out operations in this remote area. Much more likely was a strike directly north from Leningrad across the Karelian Isthmus, the 120 kilometre neck of land between the Gulf of Finland and Lake Ladoga. Here the Finns had constructed 109 reinforced concrete positions across the entire width of the isthmus. It was strongest on its flanks, where it was covered by fixed coastal artillery. The most dangerous section of the line was astride the shortest route between Viipuri and Leningrad, where two major roads went through the village of Summa and towards the village of Lahde. The Finns erected vast fields of barbed wire entanglements and laid thousands of mines along the most likely approach routes. The entire Karelian Isthmus was belted as well by a line of anti-tank obstacles, 5 to 7 rows deep, granite monoliths that had been sunk into the earth. Although it couldn't be compared to the Maginot or Siegfried lines, it was better than nothing. Mannerheim thought that with a little luck, it might hold the Soviets up for a week to 10 days. By the last week of November, the Soviets had deployed a force which numbered 450,000 men and included 23 rifle divisions, 2,000 tanks and 1,000 aircraft, which represented about 25% of the USSR's active service strength at that time. As the Finns anticipated, the heaviest concentration was on the Karelian Isthmus. Here, Soviet 7th Army consisted of 12 rifle divisions, 1 mechanized corps, 3 tank brigades, and 12 artillery regiments, which amounted to 200,000 men and 1,500 tanks. What the Finns had not anticipated was that the Soviets would deploy sizable forces all along the 800-kilometer frontier, which ran from the northern shore of Lake Ladoga all the way to the Arctic coast. To the immediate north of Lake Ladoga was the Soviet 8th Army. 6 rifle divisions and 2 tank brigades, comprising 130,000 men and 400 tanks. Further north, 9th Army had deployed 5 rifle divisions in 3 separate columns. While in the Arctic, 14th Army had 3 rifle divisions. All told, 9th and 14th armies consisted of 140,000 men and 140 tanks. The Soviets had achieved a crushing superiority over the Finnish army of 3-1 in manpower, 80-1 in tanks, 5-1 in artillery, and 5.5-1 in aircraft. These force ratios had only been achieved by drafting in an enormous number of raw recruits, who at best were capable only of the most rigid operational and tactical maneuvers. But this did not really matter if the leadership was solid. In overall command of operations against Finland was General K.N. Meretskov. Hard-working and with a highly developed sense of what was politically possible, Meretskov was no fool. In a report to his Leningrad party boss, he warned of the inherent dangers of crossing Finland's perilous terrain. On the 29th of October, Defense Commissar K.E. Voroshilov ordered Meretskov to develop an operational plan for the encirclement and complete annihilation of the Finnish army by means of coordinated land, sea and air attacks. A month later, all was ready. Soviet air forces were to strike the main population centers of Finland, paralyzing the main communication and transportation system, and destroying the small Finnish air force. Simultaneously, the Baltic fleet would bombard and neutralize Finnish coastal fortifications, while naval landing forces seized key islands in the Gulf of Finland. While these operations were still underway, Soviet armored columns were to strike deep into the heart of Finland on four major axes of advance on a 1,000-kilometer front, from Karelia in the south to Petsamo in the north. Within days, it would all be over. To face this onslaught, Finland had managed to mobilize about 180,000 men, organized into eight infantry divisions and a number of independent battalions. The main strength was concentrated on the Karelian Isthmus, where six divisions of two corps took up defensive positions along the Mannerheim line. To the north of Lake Ladoga, manning a line of about 100 kilometers, were another two divisions, organized into another corps. The remaining 1,000 kilometers to the Arctic Sea was covered by the North Finland Group, a collection of civic guards, border guards, and activated reservists. Most Finnish units were made up of men from the same geographical regions. Company, platoon and battalion officers were usually well known to their men from peacetime and were often addressed by their first names or nicknames during combat. There was probably less saluting and less parade ground spit and polish than in any other army in Europe. Finnish troops knew they were in the army to fight. Finnish commanders were to experience two very different types of combat. A grinding, attritional defensive battle in the Karelian Isthmus, and a war of rapid maneuver and sudden ambush north of Lake Ladoga. Mannerheim's commanders at the operational level in Karelia were General Hugo Oesterman, commander of the Army of the Karelian Isthmus, and his corps commanders, General Harold Ulqvist, who commanded 2nd Corps, and General Erich Heinrichs, who commanded 3rd Corps. They were intelligent officers, capable of highly flexible responses to difficult situations, but they lacked experience. The men disagreed with Mannerheim's argument for a layered defense of the Karelian Isthmus, and were much more enthusiastic about launching a counter-offensive when the initial Soviet thrust had been blunted. The Jaeger tradition of Finnish officers was put into practice in the forest fighting north of Lake Ladoga. Here, the heroes of a guerrilla war on skis emerged to capture the popular imagination, not just of Finland, but of virtually the entire world. Men like business executive Paavo Talvola, the prominent lawyer Hjalmar Stalasvuo, and the rabble-rousing right-wing politician Kurt Wallenius led their forces with a flair and a dash completely foreign to the Soviet army of that time. At least one famed Finnish ski commander, Kurt Wallenius, discovered that he couldn't take the pressure. Appointed to command a hastily formed reserve on the Mannerheim line in late February, he immediately took to the bottle to steady his nerves and stayed drunk for 3 days. On the 3rd of March, Mannerheim relieved him of command. The Finns knew that in any war with the USSR, they would be on the defensive, but they vowed that it should be an active defense. They were light on firepower, but very good in terms of mobility and lower-level tactics. The forest itself dictated a heavy emphasis on individual initiative and small unit operations, quasi-guerrilla style. Marksmanship, mental agility, woodcraft, orienteering, camouflage and physical fitness were stressed, and parade ground complements were discouraged. unconventional tactics, ambushes, long-range patrols, deceptions, raids, were enshrined as doctrine and refined. The Finns intended to absorb the first Soviet strikes, delay the enemy, let him wear himself down, and then counterattack. Just after dawn, on the 30th of November 1939, Russian SB-2 medium bombers attacked strategic points in Helsinki, killing 200 on the first day of the war. Over the next 48 hours, reports poured into Mannerheim's HQ of Soviet attacks from the Gulf of Finland in the south to the Arctic coast. In Finland's far north, elements of the White Sea Fleet bombarded Finn positions on the Rajbachi Peninsula. Shortly afterwards, troops of the Soviet 104th Division stormed ashore. Faced with overwhelming odds, the Finns pulled back south along the Arctic Highway, abandoning the port of Petsamo. There was no alternative. Mannerheim knew that any attempt to hold the port would result in a siege, and he had no way of keeping the garrison supplied. On the 1st of December, the Soviet cruiser Kirov and two large destroyers opened fire on Finnish fortifications at Hanko on the Gulf of Finland. Finnish coastal batteries remained silent until the Russian ships were within range and then loosed a salvo. They scored a direct hit on one of the destroyers, which put about abruptly and limped out of range behind a smokescreen. Finnish batteries then straddled Kirov, with at least one shell smashing into the engine room. Losing power rapidly, Kirov withdrew from action as fast as she could and was towed back to Kronstadt. On land, the Finns were doing less well. As Mannerheim thought, the main Soviet offensive thrust came up the Karelian Isthmus. It was here, on a front of some 80 kilometers, that Meretskov had concentrated 120,000 troops, supported by 1,000 tanks. Directly in front of the main defensive line, Mannerheim had created a buffer zone, some 20 to 45 kilometers deep, in which villages had been razed and booby-trapped, and mines had been planted. About 21,000 Finnish soldiers held strong points in this zone, their role to break up and disorganize Soviet formations before they reached the main defensive positions. In some places, this strategy worked. On the southwest coast, the Soviets ran into determined resistance before the village of Terijoki, where Finnish companies counterattacked during the night of the 30th of November, 1st of December, and succeeded in retaking lost positions. But elsewhere, Finnish forces abandoned positions, sometimes on the merest rumour that the Russians were approaching. On the 4th of December, a furious Mannerheim stormed into General Oersterman's HQ, demanding that the forces in the buffer zone offer firmer resistance to the Soviet advance. Oersterman, who regarded the buffer zone policy as too risky for Finland's semi-trained troops, offered his resignation, which Mannerheim refused to accept. Had the Soviets reached the Mannerheim line at this time, they may have triggered a major crisis in the Finnish ranks. But the Russians advanced sluggishly, their massive mechanized columns immobilized for hours at a time in huge traffic jams. It was not until the 6th of December that Soviet forward units reached the line, and not until the 8th of December that artillery and ammunition had been brought forward in significant quantities. By this time, Mannerheim was receiving alarming reports from all along Finland's 1,000-kilometre frontier with the USSR north of Lake Ladoga. A fairly developed road and rail system ran along the northern shore of the lake, and along this advanced three Soviet divisions, far more than Mannerheim had thought the Soviets could logistically sustain. Here, there was no defence line. The defending troops, Finland's 4th Corps, too weak to hold ground, had to rely on a mobile defence. Finnish sappers blew up a dam on Lake Suojärvi, about 16 kilometres northeast of Ladoga, which flooded the Soviets' main line of advance for a few hours before the water froze. On the 3rd of December, the Finns attempted a counterattack, but the sudden appearance of Russian tanks stopped them in their tracks. They disengaged hurriedly and withdrew to the western bank of the Aitujaki River. The The next day, the Soviets crossed in strength, pushing the Finns back to the road junction at Tolvajärvi, from where it was possible that the Soviets might come around the north of Lake Ladoga and take the Mannerheim line from the rear. Further north still, the Soviet 163rd and 44th Divisions ground along tracks and logging roads towards the main north-south highway junction at Suomussalmi, a town with a peacetime population of about 4,000. So certain was Mannerheim that the Soviets would not be able to operate in such a remote area that he had deployed only a few companies of border guards. The Soviets pushed them aside with ease. On the 7th of December, Soviet columns rolled into the straggling streets of Suomussalmi. From here, the Soviets were poised to advance west across the narrow waste of Finland and cut the country in half. With the exception of a naval reversal off Hanko, the first week of operations had gone well for the Soviets. It seemed that another week would secure victory. They were so confident, they established a new government in one of the villages they had liberated in the Karelian Isthmus, a government which was sure to be in Helsinki in the very near future. In Helsinki, by the end of the first week, many members of the government and several quite senior soldiers were close to despair. A younger, less experienced commander might well have succumbed to panic. But this was Mannerheim's fifth war, and he reviewed the growing crisis with icy calm. He'd been surprised by the sheer extent of the Soviet thrusts, but he knew that so many over such long distances would stretch Soviet logistics. Although Finnish forces everywhere had been driven back, a Soviet breakthrough had not been achieved. Mannerheim took prompt action. The commanding officer of 4th Corps, who'd been unable to prevent a near disaster north of Lake Ladoga, he replaced with Major General Woldemar Haglund, a veteran of the 27th Jägers. He also redeployed his scarce resources, sending reinforcements to 4th Corps north of Lake Ladoga and to Suomussalmi. But he kept most of his reserves concentrated on the Karelian Isthmus. Finland could afford to give ground anywhere but there. On the Karelian front, Merezkov knew that the Finns would concentrate their forces on the central west of the Mannerheim line at Suma, where a developed road and rail system ran northwest to Viipuri and then on to Helsinki. So he decided to attack first on the Finns' eastern flank, near the village of Taipale, where the Mannerheim line met Lake Ladoga. Enough pressure here, Merezkov reasoned, would persuade the Finns to commit their reserves, at which point the Soviets would strike at Suma. The first Russian probes crossed the Taipale River on the 6th of December and found the far bank apparently undefended. More battalions rushed forward to exploit what seemed to be a gap in the Mannerheim line. However, all was not as it seemed. The hapless Russians advanced into a carefully prepared killing ground, covered by Finnish artillery and machine guns. The first waves of Russians were cut down in a torrent of fire. To the amazement of the Finns, the Russians kept pouring units into what was clearly a trap. They failed to understand Merezkov's strategy, which was to accept high casualties in order to engage the Finns in an attritional battle and draw their strength away from Suma. Before dawn on the 14th of December, massed Soviet artillery opened up its first major bombardment of the war. At 11:30, the barrage lifted. Soviet tanks, accompanied by infantry in closely packed groups, moved forward. The Finns waited until the Russians reached pre-plotted firing lines and then opened up. Shrapnel tore through the dense masses of Soviet infantry, while tank after tank was hit. It took just 5 minutes to bring the Soviet attack to a halt, and then send it staggering into retreat. Meretskov fed another 2 divisions into the battle, and reinforced the artillery to 84 batteries. Although he had hoped for a breakthrough, he believed that the fighting was now of such intensity that it must have absorbed the Finnish reserve. That being so, it was time to alter the axis of attack. At 0500 on the 17th of December, Meretskov launched his main offensive against the Mannerheim line at Suma. Massed Soviet artillery opened up, and for 5 hours worked its way backwards and forwards across the Finnish positions. It was the heaviest artillery bombardment experienced anywhere in the world since those on the Western Front at the beginning of November 1918. Moving along corridors left untouched by the artillery, Soviet sappers swarmed forward, attempting to lift mines and clear obstacles. Behind them rumbled the tanks, accompanied at first by clumps of Russian infantry. But infantry and armor cooperation was poor. As the tanks pushed forward, the infantry were left behind, leaving gaps. Spotting their chance to exploit this weakness, Finnish machine gunners and mortar teams opened up on the infantry. The tanks rolled on, alone, to the line of granite anti-tank obstacles, their tracks biting into the rock monoliths and pushing the tanks skyward at a steep angle. At this point, the Finnish anti-tank teams struck. In some places, the crew of a Bofors 37mm anti-tank gun managed to get their solid 2-pound shells directly into the vulnerable bellies of the tanks, smashing the transmission or killing some of the crew. At many points in the Suma sector, the Mannerheim line was flanked by lakes, which were now frozen solid. As his frontal assaults against the line ground to a halt, Meretskov sent columns directly across the lakes in the hope of outflanking the main defences. But the shores of the lakes were made up of jumbles of granite boulders, cliffs and dense forests. There were only a handful of exits from most lakes which channeled the Russian advance. With carefully placed anti-tank guns and ambush parties, these exits were turned into killing grounds. By the 19th of December, Meretskov was becoming desperate. He had promised Stalin victory for his birthday on the 21st of December. While closely packed battalions were marched over minefields, clearing them with their own bodies, the KV tank was sent into action for the first time. A squadron of these 47-ton monsters managed to smash its way through part of the Mannerheim line and into the streets of the village of Suma. But the threatened breakthrough was quickly sealed off. Finnish infantry swarmed over the roofs of the houses, jumped onto the tops of the tanks, and fired their Sumis through the driver's vision slit, while others drenched the KVs with Molotov cocktails. On the 20th of December, Meretskov's armoured commanders reported that the assault on the Mannerheim line had cost 250 armoured vehicles, most of which had been lost in the fighting around Suma. Casualties, too, had been horrific. As General Oesterman surveyed the battlefield through his binoculars, the sight of dozens of burnt-out Soviet tanks and dark piles of dead Russian infantry convinced him that the time had come for a counterattack. Mannerheim was much more cautious, but he too seems to have been carried away by a new infectious spirit of optimism. At 06:30 on the 23rd of December, Finnish artillery opened up for a 10-minute barrage, behind which 3 Finnish divisions, the 1st, 4th and 6th, advanced towards the Russians. They overran Russian outposts with relative ease, but as they advanced, Russian resistance increased. Faced with an increasingly resolute Soviet defence, the Finnish divisions began to collapse into a huge, ungainly mob, unresponsive to the commands of the officers. Realizing that he had a first-class debacle on his hands, Mannerheim called off the attack. The Finns lost 1,500 men on the 23rd of December, a salutary reminder of the cost of such operations. Elsewhere, however, lightly equipped semi-trained Finnish forces were beginning to strike back at Soviet columns. In the forest vastness north of Lake Ladoga, battalions of white-clad ski troops could move rapidly around the flanks of Soviet columns, striking them from unexpected directions. From these guerrilla pinpricks, a series of increasingly impressive counterattacks began to emerge. They began immediately north of Ladoga, in the area of Tolvajärvi and Ilomantsi. On Finnish Independence Day, the 6th of December, when Finnish fortunes seemed to hit rock bottom, Colonel Paavo Talvela, an old friend of Mannerheim's, reported to the Marshal's HQ at Mikkel. Mannerheim was brief and to the point. All Finnish forces in the Tolvajärvi-Ilomantsi corridor were henceforth designated Group Talvela. The colonel was to drive north and stabilize the situation. But this was easier said than done. When Talvela reached the front later that day, he found the Finns frightened, demoralized, and getting ready to retreat once again. Talvela realized that something had to be done quickly, in case the entire defense north of Ladoga collapsed. The best way of restoring their confidence, Talvela reasoned, was to give them a quick victory. Displaying a boldness that verged on the reckless, Talvela selected a few companies who seemed to be coping better than the rest, and just before midnight sent them across the ice of Lake Tolvajärvi to raid Russian bivouacs. By 0200 on the 7th of December, 140 Finns, whose weapons included 16 light machine guns, lay spread out along a low ridge looking down into a Russian battalion encamped around blazing fires. Rarely have troops been presented with such clear and easy targets. The Finns opened fire. A withering barrage cut through the Russian ranks for 4 minutes, reducing the clumps of men to forlorn heaps. When they stopped, there was no movement. The entire battalion had been wiped out. Russian units to the left and right flanks began firing wildly, and then at each other. The Finns slipped back across the ice to the sounds of an ever more ferocious battle, as the Russians killed each other. News of the success of the raid reinvigorated the Finns. The following day, on the 8th of December, a force operating to the north under Colonel Paa Elkholm ambushed and annihilated a Russian battalion as it attempted to find its way out of a frozen bog. With success like this, Talvela felt confident enough to order a general counterattack. For the next 2 days, the Finns kept attacking along the flanks of the strung-out Russian units. The temperature was now minus 25 degrees. The snowdrifts were deep and solid, and the Russians had no skis. As the Finns swept around them, the Russians tried to hit back with tactical airstrikes, which helped Soviet morale but had little chance of locating their well-camouflaged enemy. Late on the 21st of December, two companies of Finns crossed the ice of Lake Tolvajärvi to attack the village of Olgajärvi from the north. Two companies attacked from the south. The Russians had turned each building into a strong point, and every one had to be destroyed in turn with grenades, Molotov cocktails, and satchel charges. It was a bloody and exhausting business, but by 1400 hours, the Russians were in retreat. The Finns pressed on for 2 more days, reaching the Aitojoki River on the 23rd of December, when Mannerheim called off the attack. Since the beginning of the offensive on the 7th of December, Talvela's force of 6,000 men had suffered 2,000 casualties, of whom 630 had been killed. The Finns counted more than 4,000 Russian bodies, and estimated that at least another 5,000 had been wounded, of whom some 600 had become prisoners. Further south, along the northern shore of Lake Ladoga, General Haglund launched a counteroffensive against the Soviet 168th Division, which was spread out along dozens of kilometers of snowbound road. as Finnish ski troops swept around the Russian flanks, chopping into the columns in elongated pockets, the Russian troops deployed for all-round defence and began digging in. By the second week in January, Russian columns had been cut into 11 pockets, known to the Finns as motis. Haglund barely had enough men to maintain a permanent presence at each moti, and instead conducted a mobile siege, with ski troops keeping the Russians off balance through a series of hit-and-run attacks. Most motis were too powerful to attack directly. They contained scores of tanks, hundreds of guns, and the men could survive for a time by eating their horses and by supply drops from the Soviet Air Force. The Finns set up anti-aircraft guns around the motis and sometimes succeeded in duplicating Russian signals requesting logistic drops, so that the supplies came floating down to their own rather than the Soviet positions. The Russians attempted to supplement the airdrop by bringing in supplies across Lake Ladoga at night, but these columns were frequently ambushed by Finnish ski patrols. As Soviet supplies dwindled, pocket after pocket was faced with the choice of surrendering to the Finns or attempting to break out. Invariably, they chose the latter course. The 3,600 Russians inside the East Lameti Moti came charging out in mid-January, hoping to overwhelm the single battalion besieging them, but ran into withering machine gun fire. After the massacre, the Finns counted more than 3,000 Russian dead, including a Soviet general who was surrounded by the bodies of four female typists, each clutching a rifle. By the end of January, 8 of the 11 motis along the northern shore of Lake Ladoga had fallen to General Haglund's forces. During December, the news from Finland had been greeted in the Kremlin with disquiet, then alarm, and finally rage. In late December, Stalin met with his military chiefs. The Soviet leader was painfully aware that the world was comparing his own failure to defeat Finland with Hitler's rapid destruction of Poland 3 months earlier. He ordered the execution of some of the officers who had failed, but there was to be no wholesale bloodletting. Stalin knew that the poor performance of the Soviet army was partly due to his own purge of senior and middle-ranking officers. He was a survivor, and his response to the crisis was pragmatic. The Leningrad military district that had been conducting the campaign was reorganized and became the Northwestern Army Group, or Front. To command at the operational level, Stalin chose General Semyon Konstantinovich Timoshenko, a former barrel maker, who had proved an effective army commander in the short Polish campaign. Timoshenko's first step was to reorganize the Northwestern Front, creating two armies, 7th and 14th. Once he established a new command structure, he moved in fresh divisions. Like Merezkov before him, he identified a 16-kilometer-wide corridor at Sumer as the best place to effect a breakthrough. Here, he assembled 10 infantry divisions, 5 tank brigades, and 2,800 guns, enough artillery to give him a front-wide ratio of 50 guns per kilometer. During the last weeks of January, Soviet patrols probed the Mannerheim line, identifying the location of bunkers, and even bringing back pieces of concrete for analysis. On the 1st of February, Northwestern Front's artillery opened up, pumping 300,000 shells into Finnish positions in the first 24 hours. In the Sumer sector alone, 400 shells per minute rained on Finnish positions. Under this crushing bombardment, some of the Finnish fortifications began to crumble. Behind the bombardment, shock troops of the 123rd Division skirmished forward to clear corridors through the barbed wire, the minefields, and the anti-tank obstacles to the main defences. Not all the bunkers were mutually supporting, and some isolated positions fell to the Russians, although the Finns almost always counterattacked and recaptured them. By the 10th of February, the Soviets were attacking all along the line, forcing the Finns into a battle of attrition they could not win. to the alarm of the defenders, Finnish batteries were no longer responding to Russian shelling. The Finns were running out of ammunition, and battery commanders were now under strict orders not to fire, except in cases of dire emergency. Finnish soldiers watched with frustration as masses of Russian infantry deployed to their front, and their guns remained silent. They now had to rely on machine guns, rifles and mortars to prevent a breakthrough. But still, the Mannerheim line held. The Russians attempted to outflank the line by sending columns across the ice of the Gulf of Finland and Lake Ladoga. Finnish coastal batteries sent armor-piercing shells smashing into the frozen surface. Airbursts of shrapnel tore through the Soviet ranks, pushing them to flee across the fractured ice, where many hundreds drowned. On the 12th of February, a thick fog blanketed the Gulf of Finland. The Russians, advancing under its cover, got to within 50 meters of the Finnish shore when the fog lifted and the defenders' machine guns cut them down in heaps. The Finns still had astonishing successes, but Soviet numbers began to tell. By the second week in February, Finnish reinforcements consisted mainly of 16-year-old boys and reservists in their mid-50s. On the 14th of February, casualties in the Suma sector reached crisis point, and Mannerheim authorized a withdrawal. But with Suma gone, the remainder of the front was no longer viable. At 1600 hours on the 15th of February, Mannerheim ordered a general retreat back to an intermediate line, which was much less fortified. It took the Soviets 72 hours to close up. By the 18th of February, positions along the intermediate line were coming under increasing pressure. Finnish aerial reconnaissance and radio intercepts revealed that the Soviets were moving up artillery and vast stores of ammunition in preparation for another massive bombardment. Because the defences of the intermediate position were much less strong than those of the Mannerheim line, the Marshal could see no good reason to leave his troops in a position where they would be slaughtered. Between the 27th and 28th of February, the Finns withdrew to a third position, the reserve line, so that Timoshenko's shells crashed down on empty trenches. Mannerheim had saved his army, but it was now at its last defence line. By the 2nd of March, Timoshenko had 30 divisions, supported by at least 1,200 tanks and other armoured vehicles, and 2,000 aircraft poised to smash the Finns. A day later, wave upon wave of men and machines of Soviet 28th Corps attacked across the ice of the Gulf of Finland. They suffered huge casualties from artillery and air attack, but managed to establish two small beachheads to the west of Viipuri, thus outflanking the Finns' last defence line. Mannerheim, who was now severely ill with flu, knew that any delay in evacuating Viipuri might prove fatal. But he also knew that if he could hold out until the thaw, perhaps only a week away, Russian guns and tanks would sink into a morass. There were only two things which could save Finland: the spring and the intervention of foreign powers, particularly Britain and France. Unfortunately, the winter of 1939-40 was one of the coldest and longest of the 20th century. Foreign intervention was proving as illusory as the spring. Some foreign help had arrived, but it was in the form of semi-trained companies and battalions of idealistic volunteers, mainly from Sweden, but with contingents from many other European countries and the United States. On the 29th of February, Finnish diplomats had been on the point of accepting new Russian demands when an urgent message arrived from Paris. The French government urged Finland to fight on and promised the immediate dispatch of 50,000 troops and 100 bombers. On the strength of this promise, the Finns rejected Moscow's offer. But the French offer was dependent on the cooperation of Great Britain, and while Britain wished to send forces to Norway and Sweden to interfere with Germany's supplies of iron ore, London was not necessarily interested in going to Finland to fight the Russians. In addition, any Anglo-French intervention force destined for Finland was going to have to get the permission of the Norwegian and Swedish governments to cross their territory, and this was something Oslo and Stockholm were not prepared to allow. Like the prospect of the thaw, the promise of foreign intervention caused the Finns to hang on beyond the 11th hour. On the night of the 7th and 8th of March, the Russians expanded their beachhead on the Gulf coast. bringing their artillery within range of the Viipuri-Helsinki highway. The Finnish 23rd Division fell to pieces. One battalion threw down its weapons and fled to the west, while other battalions refused to counterattack. 2 days later, Finland made a desperate appeal to Norway and Sweden to open their borders, knowing that the appeal would be rejected. Finnish diplomats had already decided they had no choice other than to accede to Russian demands, and on the 13th of March signed a ceasefire in Moscow, which gave Stalin everything he had wanted. The Russo-Finnish War had lasted just 105 days. Finland had lost 25,000 dead and 43,500 wounded, out of a total population of fewer than 4 million. The Soviet losses were much greater, at least 250,000 dead, and about the same number wounded. The Finns took 5,000 Russian prisoners, a surprisingly low number that says much about the severity of the fighting. Though Finland had had to bow to the inevitable, she had earned a reputation as a formidable small power, a nation not to be meddled with. Conversely, even though the Soviets eventually succeeded, the reputation of the Soviet army as a fighting force had been destroyed. American and British observers rated the USSR as a third-rate military power, a hapless giant, incapable of defending itself. So too did the Germans. In fact, in April 1940, the Supreme Military Soviet met to sift through the lessons of the war and push through a program of radical reform. It was just in time. The Russo-Finnish War, the first round of the struggle for Scandinavia, created the conditions in which the Anglo-French War against Germany would spread to Norway. In Britain, the First Lord of the Admiralty, Winston Churchill, had been urging a landing at Narvik on the northwest coast of Norway. This move, ostensibly designed to help the Finns, would threaten Germany's iron ore supplies, dragging Hitler north. It was here that Britain could use her overwhelming naval superiority to wear down German power. The plan had two problems. First, Norway was neutral. Second, Neville Chamberlain and the Foreign Secretary Lord Halifax disliked Churchill's scheme. On the 14th of February 1940, RAF reconnaissance spotted the German auxiliary ship the Altmark in Norwegian territorial waters, steaming south at top speed. Churchill knew she had on board several hundred prisoners taken by the Graf Spee. He decided to rescue them, even at the cost of violating Norwegian neutrality. British destroyers chased the Altmark into a narrow fjord near Stavanger. Then, on Churchill's instructions, Blue Jackets boarded her and liberated the prisoners. Lord Halifax was horrified. But Britain rallied round Churchill. Edouard Daladier, the French Premier, supported Churchill's aggressive Scandinavian strategy. Not only did the defence of Finland unite his fragile government, but Daladier hoped that a Scandinavian expedition would draw the Germans north, away from the Maginot Line. When Finland made peace with the USSR, Daladier was forced to resign after losing a vote of confidence in the Chamber of Deputies. Paul Reynaud formed a new government, but he also faced mounting pressure to wage the war more vigorously. London rejected his proposal to launch an operation in the Caspian and Black Sea area, designed to cut Germany's petroleum supplies. But the British government backed an additional proposal to sow mines in Norwegian territorial waters to stop the ore traffic from Narvik. Mine-laying destroyers slipped out of Scapa Flow, escorted by the battlecruiser Renown, commanded by Admiral Whitworth. Back in Scottish ports, troop-laden warships destined for Stavanger, Bergen, Trondheim and Narvik waited to forestall the anticipated German move. It was a cunning plan. Nearly 4 months earlier, on the 14th of December 1939, Adolf Hitler had received a visitor from Norway. The 53-year-old Vidkun Quisling, still a serving officer and a brilliant mathematician, was the former Minister of Defense and founder of the new National Union, a party which embraced National Socialist-type principles. Quisling hated and feared Soviet communism. He thought the Russian attack on Finland heralded a much larger war in Scandinavia and proposed to use German assistance to take power in Norway, in order, as he said, to forestall occupation by the British, a civil war, and the Bolshevization of the whole country. Hitler advised him that Norway should remain neutral for the time being, but promised massive German support in the face of a British threat. Later that same day, Hitler ordered Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, or OKW, to begin work on Studi Nord, a contingency plan for the occupation of Norway. Grand Admiral Erich Raeder, commander-in-chief of the German fleet, played a central role. It was he who had set up the meeting between Quisling and Hitler. Control of the Norwegian coastline would give his submarines an increased radius of action, while his surface ships could more easily run the British blockade. The Navy's plan, presented on the 20th of January, called for landings along the entire coast, from Oslo to Tromsø, and helped shape Weserabung, or Operation Weser. The seizure of the Altmark turned Weserabung from a contingency to an operational plan. A furious Hitler ordered full speed ahead. Admiral Gunther Leutchens, the commander of Germany's battle fleet, was tasked with implementing Weserabung. Leutchens, who had served in small boat squadrons throughout the First World War, understood the problems of littoral warfare. Control of the operation went to the army. General Nicholas von Falkenhorst, who had served in Finland in 1918, headed the world's first unified tri-service command, which subordinated naval and air units to the ground force commander. Summoned to the Chancellery on the 21st of February 1940, Falkenhorst was offered command of Weserabung and jumped at the chance. Told to come back at 1700 hours with a plan of campaign, Falkenhorst bought a travel guide, retired to his hotel room, and literally worked on the back of an envelope. He decided to use one division to capture each of Norway's major harbours, Oslo, Stavanger, Bergen, Trondheim and Narvik. Although not as detailed as the OKW plan, Falkenhorst's concept was very similar. Hitler approved it at once. In order to facilitate inter-service cooperation, Falkenhorst worked direct to Hitler, rather than through the Army Chief of Staff. Inter-service rivalry did not entirely disappear, but no other nation at that time could have rivaled the efficiency of these arrangements. Falkenhorst's most famous subordinate was Hitler's favorite general, the highly skilled Major General Eduard Dietl, commander of the 3rd Mountain Division. Dietl, fanatically loyal to his Führer, was a Bavarian, a mountaineer, who after the First World War joined the Nazi Party, becoming member number 120, which made him senior to Hitler. As a captain of the Bavarian General Staff in the 1920s, Dietl tried to sabotage military opposition to Hitler's attempted putsch, and later became one of Hitler's chief informants in the Reichswehr. Falkenhorst tasked his division with the capture of Narvik. Closer to Scapa Flow than to any German base, it would almost certainly prove the most difficult objective. Weserabung would require the deployment of the bulk of the German Navy. Two battlecruisers, two old battleships, a pocket battleship, two heavy cruisers, four light cruisers, 14 destroyers, 20 torpedo boats, 50 minesweepers, and 31 U-boats. The most powerful were the battlecruisers Scharnhorst and Gneisenau. They displaced 31,800 tons and mounted a main armament of 9 11-inch guns, which were too small for ships of that size and quite outclassed by the 15 and 16-inch guns mounted on many British battleships. However, they were well armoured, had good anti-aircraft armament, and they were fast. The ship with the most awesome reputation was Lützow, a pocket battleship. She displaced only 11,700 tons, but mounted six 11-inch guns in two triple turrets. However, her armour was no better than that of a heavy cruiser, and her top speed of only 26 knots meant that she was slower than most modern battleships. Despite her formidable appearance, Lützow and the other pocket battleship were products of a deeply flawed design. The heavy cruisers, Admiral Hipper and Blücher, following a more conventional design, were among the most effective of their class in any navy of the world. They were heavily armoured, displaced 14,000 tons, and mounted eight 8-inch and 12 4.1-inch guns. Like the pocket battleships, many German destroyers were formidably armed with 5.9-inch guns, making them lethal in ship-to-ship actions with other destroyers. The U-boats, which were to form a flanking screen, were mainly the 865-ton Type 7 Cs, armed with four bow and one stern torpedo tubes. These rugged and reliable boats were the workhorse of the German submarine service, but their crews were inexperienced. British naval superiority was immense. Germany relied on land-based aircraft to redress the balance. Just over 1,000 aircraft were detailed to support Weserbürgen, about 230 fighters, 270 bombers, and 500 transport aircraft. The period of maximum danger would lie between the beginning of the operation and the establishment of the first air bases in Norway, because aircraft based in Germany could range only over the southern third of Norway. The Luftwaffe's excellent ME-109 could just reach the southeast coast of Norway. Only the twin-engined Messerschmitt Bf-110 had the range to operate further north. The workhorse of German bomber squadrons, the Heinkel HE-111H, had a relatively heavy bomb load, but lacked protection. A much better aircraft was the Junkers Ju-88, which had a greater range, was slightly faster, and could carry a bomb load only slightly smaller. The Ju-88 was equally adept as a fighter and a dive bomber. Once they'd established themselves in southern Norway, the Germans would be able to deploy the Junkers Ju-87 Stuka, the finest dive bomber in the world at that time, which would prove to be particularly effective against a large target like a ship. The campaign would also see the first operational employment of the Fallschirmjäger, the Luftwaffe's paratroops. Their task was to seize airfields in Denmark, a subsidiary operation codenamed Weserbürgen Sud, and at Stavanger and Oslo. They would go into action in Ju-52 transports, 18 fully equipped men in each aircraft. The bulk of German ground forces were to be drawn from five divisions: the 69th, 163rd, 181st, 196th, and 214th. Three of these divisions, the 163rd, 181st and 196th, had been formed in January 1940, and the other two had been created in the summer of 1939. These formations were composed largely of reservists, indicating a belief that if the Navy and Air Force were successful, the Army would have little to do. Nevertheless, specialist troops were attached to the expedition. Like the companies of Fallschirmjäger, they were charged with securing key objectives at the outset of the campaign. The most famous were the 2nd and 3rd Mountain Divisions, which were composed of Austrians, although they included a few Bavarians. The Innsbruck-based 2nd Mountain Division was composed almost entirely of Tyroleans, while the 3rd Mountain Division, originally part of the Austrian army, had been integrated into the Wehrmacht after the Anschluss. Its men hailed from Graz, and their commander was the famed Major General Eduard Dietl. The men, all genuine mountaineers, were used to conditions rather colder than even the most northern extremities of Norway. With a small population and a long coastline, Norwegians knew their armed forces could make only a show of resistance, perhaps buying enough time for British intervention. The Navy had a few seaplanes for patrolling territorial waters, while the Army Air Force had reconnaissance aircraft based at Trondheim and Narvik. Norway's fighter strength comprised 9 obsolete Gloster Gladiators, based near Oslo. More potent was the squadron of 9 Italian-built Caproni Bergamaschi CA-311 light bombers, based at Sola, in the extreme southwestern tip of Norway. The Eidsvoll and Norge, 2 old armoured coast defence vessels, were in Narvik. The remainder of the Navy, 7 destroyers and 40 relatively modern gun and torpedo boats, patrolled the coast. The Army, a militia built around a small regular cadre, would reach 106,000 men, organised into 6 divisions when fully mobilised. But thus far, only battalions at Lillehammer, Kristiansand, Stavanger and Bergen, and the equivalent of a brigade near Narvik, had been called up. The main firepower of Norway's forces was tied up in coastal artillery batteries, guarding Oslo Fjord, Kristiansand, Bergen, and the entrance to Trondheim Fjord. Many of the guns were old, but they were manned by well-trained crews. ...280 miles to the west lay Scapa Flow, the main base of the British Home Fleet. In the spring of 1940, it comprised 14 battleships and battlecruisers, more than 2 dozen heavy and light cruisers, and some 60 destroyers and 50 submarines. The Home Fleet also boasted 4 aircraft carriers, Eagle, Hermes, Furious, and Ark Royal. The Achilles heel of this immense force was its vulnerability to air attack. Ships had been given extra deck armour and some high-angle guns, which were only accurate when a ship was not pitching in heavy seas, and which were slow firing. To improve anti-aircraft fire, the Navy was introducing the Bitten class of anti-aircraft sloop, equipped with 3 twin 4-inch anti-aircraft guns, and new fire control systems and stabilisers. The Bitten class represented a quantum leap for the Royal Navy in anti-aircraft capability, but there were only 4 in service. Britain's carriers, which could launch only 150 Fairey Swordfish torpedo bombers or Blackburn Skua dive bombers, could provide little protection. Moreover, only the RAF's Bristol Blenheim could reach Norway from British bases. It could acquit itself well against the ME-110, could easily catch the HE-111 or the JU-52, but was outclassed by the ME-109. The 5 infantry brigades earmarked for Scandinavia were from the Territorial Army. In 1939 it had been doubled in size. Battalions had been split in 2 and brought up to strength with raw recruits. Efficient battalions had been disorganised and their combat effectiveness massively reduced until the new troops could be properly trained. The brigades were lightly equipped, they lacked armour and artillery and were not ready for anything as complex as an amphibious operation along the Norwegian coast. The French had also allocated forces to Scandinavia, elements of the Chasseurs Alpins and the Foreign Legion. The Chasseurs Alpins were expert ski troops, but unfortunately a quartermaster had forgotten to pack the straps which attached the skis to the boots. In the weeks following the Altmark incident, Hitler received many reports that Britain intended to mine Norwegian waters and occupy Norwegian ports. On the 2nd of April, he announced that Weserabung would be launched at 0515 on the 9th of April. Between the 3rd and the 6th of April, transport and tanker groups set sail from Germany's Baltic ports. And then in the early hours of the 7th of April, Admiral Leutchens gave the order for Gneisenau to rendezvous with the battlecruiser Scharnhorst and 10 destroyers, carrying 2,000 troops for Narvik. Also at sea were the heavy cruiser Admiral Hipper and 4 destroyers with 1,700 troops for Narvik. They steamed north in steadily worsening weather. Battered by a westerly gale, the destroyers had difficulty maintaining the 26 knots set by Gneisenau. As dawn broke on the 8th, 3 of the destroyers had become separated from the convoy. Meanwhile, at Scapa Flow, reconnaissance reports indicated that enemy warships were sailing north at high speed along the Norwegian coast. To Admiral Forbes, all was clear. They would skirt the Norwegian coast and then drive west, breaking out into the North Atlantic. The chance for the big all-gun battle had come at last. Forbes ordered the troops already on board cruisers and destroyers for Operation R4 to disembark, and then sent the home fleet racing northeast, chasing the tail of the German task force. He also alerted Admiral Whitworth aboard the battlecruiser Renown, which was off Narvik and sailing south along the Norwegian coast, directly towards the German convoys, to be on the lookout for a German attempt to break west. Forbes had the German fleet in a vice, but he didn't know it. The first encounter between the fleets was accidental. One of the Renown's escorts, the destroyer Glowworm, had become separated from the rest of the force on the 6th of April. Shortly after dawn on the 8th of April, about 100 miles northwest of Trondheim, she blundered into the destroyers Hans Ludemann and Anim, also out of contact with their task force. For nearly an hour, in mountainous seas, the destroyers exchanged ineffectual fire, which brought the heavy cruiser Admiral Hipper into the fray. Hipper's salvos brought down Glowworm's foremast and the radio aerials. Recognizing that escape was impossible, Glowworm's captain, Lieutenant Commander Broadmead Roop, closed on Hipper and launched 5 torpedoes, all of which missed. Hit again by an 8-inch shell, Glowworm fired her last torpedoes and then swung directly for Hipper. Plunging through the waves at 20 knots, the 1,300-ton destroyer smashed into the starboard hull of the Hipper, ripping away some 130 feet of armor plating and her torpedo tubes. As Glowworm fell away, Hipper's guns raked her. The Germans managed to pluck only 31 survivors out of the freezing, heaving Norwegian sea. Though heroic, the battle between Glowworm and Hipper indicated that the Royal Navy's command and control was poor. Having picked up a brief radio signal from Glowworm, Forbes raced ships to the location. Failing to make contact, Forbes concluded that the Germans had turned west. Apparent confirmation was soon to come. During the afternoon, the German Trondheim group had reached its objective, but changed course several times while it waited for the appointed hour, 05:15, the following morning. A British aircraft, seeing it tacking to the west, radioed the news to Admiral Whitworth aboard Renown. The battlecruiser and her accompanying destroyers now raced off westward, leaving the approaches to Narvik clear. Upon receiving the same message, Admiral Forbes, 120 miles south of Trondheim, also veered westward. Having trapped the bulk of the German Navy, the home fleet now released it, speeding away in search of its elusive big gun battle. At 0400 on the 9th of April, Renown at last stumbled upon Gneisenau and Scharnhorst and opened fire, destroying Gneisenau's main fire control equipment. Leutchens sped off northeast, covering his trail with a smokescreen. He had no desire to hazard Germany's big ships. Besides, their job was done. They'd safely delivered the German invasion force to 5 points along the Norwegian coast, something that was just beginning to dawn on the British. At about the same time, on the morning of the 9th of April, 2 companies of Fallschirmjäger were over Denmark. The subsidiary operation Weserübung Süd was underway. Paratroopers seized the vital Vordingborg road bridge, the gateway to Copenhagen. Meanwhile, other paratroopers seized the Danish Air Force's major base at Aalborg on the Skagerrak. An equally spectacular coup took place in the heart of Copenhagen. German troops swarmed out of the hold of the cargo ship Hansestadt Danzig and secured the citadel, along with the Marienborg Palace, the king's official residence, both without resistance. Meanwhile, German columns crossed the Jutland border at 05:15, quickly brushing aside Danish resistance. At 07:20, the king ordered what was left of his armed forces to lay down their arms. As Danes woke up to a German occupation, paratroops were dropping onto the Norwegian airbase at Sola, near Stavanger. Norwegian troops opened fire, killing many paratroopers before they hit the ground. ME-109 escort fighters, operating at the limit of their range, strafed the airfield, which allowed some of the paratroopers time to complete their drops, collect their weapons, and form themselves into assault units. Stavanger was the first ever opposed parachute drop. The Fallskjermjager had achieved their objective, but casualties were heavy. All along the Norwegian coast, German amphibious forces were now approaching their disembarkation points. The transport Rhoda, carrying Luftwaffe personnel and anti-aircraft guns to Stavanger, was sunk by the Norwegian destroyer Sleipner. Admiral Hipper and her escort had a less eventful time, entering the harbour at Trondheim at 05:25, completely surprising the undermanned coastal batteries. At Bergen, the cruisers Kohn and Konigsberg, heading a force of 2 transports and 8 small torpedo boats, bluffed their way past batteries by signalling that they were a British task force. At Narvik, Commodore Bonte, leading the destroyer flotilla in the Wilhelm Heide camp, entered the harbour and sank the guardship Eidsvold. Meanwhile, the destroyer Anim, threading her way through the shipping which packed the harbour, torpedoed the Norge, which exploded into flame, rolled over, and sank. Gripped by general panic, the Norwegian garrison slipped away. Meanwhile, far to the south, the heavy cruiser Blücher, accompanied by the pocket battleship Lützow and light cruiser Emden and 13 smaller craft, had entered Oslo Fjord at about 0400. An hour later, as the Germans were slipping past Drubak, where the fjord narrows to only 600 yards, Norwegian batteries opened fire. Blücher, hit in the magazine, exploded. She capsized and sank with a loss of over 1,000 men. HE-111s now roared down on the batteries. Norwegian Gloster Gladiators intercepted the first waves, but were shot down themselves by ME-110s. Other ME-110s, landing on the runway of Oslo Airport, used their machine guns to cover a drop by paratroopers. More and more Ju-52s arrived via Aalborg, until a brigade had landed. The Germans then marched into Oslo, where Captain Spiller, the air attaché at the German embassy, told them the King and the government had left for Hamar, 70 miles to the north. Undaunted, the paratroopers set off in commandeered buses, but halfway between Hamar and Elverum ran into a roadblock manned by sharpshooters from a local rifle club. In the ensuing battle, the paratroopers suffered heavy casualties and were compelled to retreat. At 19:30 that evening, Vidkun Quisling announced on radio that he was heading a new government and ordered all resistance to cease. At Hamar, the King's ministers were split. The King wanted to fight, but many, including the commander-in-chief, General Laka, counselled capitulation. Late on the 10th of April, the King's supporters prevailed. General Laka was retired, and Colonel Ruger, now promoted to general, was appointed commander-in-chief. At 0600 on the 11th of April, Ruger addressed the nation. Norwegians in areas not yet occupied were to assemble at their mobilisation points and contain the German onslaught by setting up roadblocks to isolate German beachheads. As the government withdrew to Lillehammer at the entrance to the Gudbrandsdal Valley, Norwegian battle groups formed in rural areas to the southwest, southeast, and north of Oslo. Outside Bergen and Trondheim, and to the north of Narvik. Meanwhile, the Germans pumped in reinforcements. Allied submarines in the Skagerrak torpedoed several ships, but many got through. In addition, Ju-52 transport aircraft flew 13,000 missions, carrying nearly 30,000 troops and large quantities of urgent supplies, the largest movement of forces by air the world had yet seen. Using commandeered transport, elements of the 163rd and 196th Divisions fanned out from Oslo, pushing Norwegian pockets over the Swedish border, while others thrust north. By the 20th of April, the Germans were in contact with Norwegian positions covering Lillehammer. But by this time, the Norwegians were no longer alone. the German assault had stunned London. All British plans depended on landings being unopposed. Moreover, on the 7th of April, the Navy had hurriedly disembarked the battalions earmarked for Norway, creating massive confusion. Beset by indecision, the Cabinet eventually decided to attack Narvik. Off the coasts of Norway, the British were asserting naval superiority. British submarines torpedoed Karlsruhe and Lützow, and on the morning of the 10th of April, 15 skuas from 800 Squadron and 308 Squadron, operating from the Orkneys, sank Königsberg in Bergen. The first time dive bombers had sunk a warship. Further north, just before dawn on the 10th of April, Captain Warburton Lee took his second destroyer flotilla, Hardy, Hunter, Havoc, Hotspur and Hostile, into Narvik Field. Snow was falling and surprise was total. Skillfully avoiding collisions with merchant ships, Hardy launched torpedoes at Heidkamp, which blew off the German stern. Following closely in Hardy's wake, Hunter and Havoc opened fire with guns and torpedoes, finishing off Anton Schmidt and badly damaging Hans Ludemann, while Hostile got two direct hits on Dieter von Rohde. Believing that there were only six German destroyers in Narvik, and having accounted for four, Warburton Lee brought his ships in for a second attack, this time narrowly avoiding torpedoes fired by the stricken Dieter von Rohde. After inflicting more damage, and almost out of ammunition and torpedoes, the flotilla raced for the open sea. Unknown to Warburton Lee, the Germans had more destroyers sheltering inside fjords. As his flotilla raced down the field, Wolfgang Zenke, Erich Kullner and Erich Giese emerged from the Herangsfjord and gave chase. And then ahead, coming out of Balgenfjord, were Georg Theiler and Bernd von Arnim. In the van of the British line, Hardy faced the combined fire of the German ships alone. Hit again and again, her bridge a bloody shambles in which Warburton Lee lay dying, Hardy turned to the shore and ran aground. The next in line, Havoc, ran the gauntlet. But the third, Hunter, badly hit in the engine room, lost speed. With visibility obscured by smoke, the fourth destroyer, Hotspur, smashed into Hunter's side, pushing her over and leaving her dead in the water. Easy meat for the three pursuing destroyers. Reaching the mouth of the fjord, the surviving British destroyers encountered the German ammunition supply ship, Roenfels. Havoc opened fire. Roenfels erupted in an enormous explosion, which sent parts of the ship more than 500 feet skyward. The British returned on the 13th of April with four modern tribal-class destroyers of nearly 2,000 tons, Bedouin, Punjabi, Eskimo and Cossack, and five smaller destroyers, Hero, Forester, Foxhound, Kimberley and Icarus. They were accompanied by HMS Warspite, a 30,000-ton battleship mounting eight 15-inch guns. Near the entrance of the fjord, one of Warspite's Swordfish spotter aircraft, sighting the U-64, sank her with a direct hit by a 100-pound bomb. With Swordfish aircraft providing aerial reconnaissance, Warspite opened up on Kuhne, which disappeared up the field to join Ludemann, Zenke and Arnim. Rounding a bend, Warspite's 15-inch guns now zeroed in on Kölner and blew her apart. The British force, supported by Swordfish from the carrier Furious, steadily shepherded the Germans to the head of the field, from which there was no escape. Fighting with desperate gallantry, the German ships managed to inflict damage on three British destroyers, but in the end, were all reduced to scrap. It had been just like shelling peas, claimed Captain Crutchley, the commander of Warspite. The next day, Major General Mackesy, the land commander, arrived at Harstad at the entrance to Vestfjord, followed closely by the 24th Guards Brigade. Admiral Lord Cork, the naval commander, also came ashore. The general and the admiral had different sets of orders. Mackesy was to conduct a siege, not attacking Narvik until his logistics were fully established. Lord Cork was to attack up the fjord, while Dietl's forces were still rattled. It soon became clear that Mackesy's troops were untrained and unequipped for operations in snow and mountains. Lord Cork fumed, but there was nothing he could do. Cut off by sea and land, Dietl's force relied on air transport. Ju-52 transports carrying vital stores landed on a frozen lake at Hartwigwan. In addition, 2,600 German sailors, the survivors of the destroyer crews, were equipped from captured Norwegian army depots and formed into seven naval infantry battalions. Yielding to German pressure, Sweden also allowed supply trains to cross the border. Dietl expected an onslaught, but weeks passed, during which the only activity was skirmishing with Fleischer's newly formed Norwegian 6th Division. Meanwhile, on the 13th of April, news of Narvik encouraged the British to approve a direct assault on Trondheim. 4 days later, the Stukas severely damaged a heavy cruiser off the Norwegian coast, and the attack was cancelled. Two subsidiary operations already underway should also have been aborted, but they weren't. So, on the 16th of April, the British 146th Infantry Brigade and the French 13th Chasseurs Alpins began landing at Namsos, a small port about 100 miles to the northeast of Trondheim. Together, these formations formed Morris Force. On the same night, Sickle Force, the 148th Infantry Brigade, which comprised only two battalions, landed at the small fishing ports of Andalsnes and Molde, which lay 100 miles southwest of Trondheim. Carton de Wiart, a brave and resourceful soldier, was alarmed by the state of his troops. Morris Force comprised a few battalions of lightly equipped, not very mobile infantry. On the 20th of April, his supply situation became critical when more than 60 enemy bombers literally flattened Namsos, blowing up an ammunition dump. By this time, Carton de Wiart had sent part of Morris Force some 55 miles south along the western shore of Beistadfjord towards Trondheim. The advance guard, some companies of the King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry, were approaching Verdal on the Inner River, which was only about 40 miles from Trondheim. Other elements of Morris Force were spread all the way back to Namsos. A thaw was melting the ice on Beistadfjord and on its extension Trondheim's fjord. At 0600 on the 22nd of April, German destroyers, which had been trapped in Trondheim, ploughed through the ice up Beistadfjord to land troops on the flank and rear of 146th Brigade. Simultaneously, German troops sorted out of Trondheim, pushing the Coilies north into German roadblocks. In an epic march, the Yorkshiremen avoided German blocking positions by heading inland through waist-deep snow, their wounded and their supplies strapped to requisitioned sledges. By the 23rd of April, the whole of Morris Force was in retreat, falling back to Namsos. Meanwhile, 148th Brigade, instead of cooperating with Morris Force, had moved south of Lillehammer to dig in with the Norwegians either side of Lake Mjøsa, which lay at the base of the Gudbrandsdal. On the 21st of April, accurate German artillery fire pushed the defenders back to Farberg, about 5 miles north of Lillehammer, at the head of Lake Mjøsa. Here, the Leicesters dug in to act as a rearguard. German ski troops were soon around their flanks, and the British again pulled back, this time to a defile at Vardekampen Ridge, where the valley narrowed to less than a mile in width. The British and Norwegians, occupying a ridge overlooking the valley, expected the Germans would try to drive them from the high ground. Shortly after midday, enemy tanks rolled up the valley floor, smashed through roadblocks, and continued on up the valley, ignoring the small arms fire and light anti-tank rounds, which bounced harmlessly off their armour. Bypassed by the Germans, who now controlled the road to the north, British and Norwegian soldiers were forced up the wooded hillsides by increasingly accurate enemy shelling. Here they broke up into small parties, the better to get back through the forests and mountains. Many were captured, some found shelter with local farmers, and some headed for Sweden. A few did make it back, to bring 148th Brigade's strength up to 300, about one quarter of its strength 3 days earlier. 15th Brigade, a regular formation withdrawn from France, had landed at Andalsnes the same day. It comprised the 1st Coilie, the 1st Green Howards, and the 1st York and Lancaster Regiment, and was well equipped with anti-aircraft guns, mortars and anti-tank rifles. On the 25th of April, 1st Coilie reached Kvam at a bend in the Gudbrandsdal, where the valley narrowed to a few hundred yards. Like the 146th and 148th Brigades, it lacked heavy equipment, but its men positioned their 3-inch mortars and 2-pounder anti-tank guns with professional skill. At 0800, they ambushed the leading column of the German 196th Division, sending it reeling down the valley. Despite heavy shellfire and bombing, the Coily was still holding the following morning. It was only an order from General Paget, who had just arrived, which caused them to withdraw. The retreat was marked by several more rearguard actions. The Green Howards took over from the Coilies. They held the Germans at Kjørn throughout the 27th of April, delayed them again at Ottar on the 28th of April, and finally at Donbass 2 days later. By now, Paget had received orders to evacuate Sickleforce. A furious Ruger saw this as betrayal. He wanted Norwegian troops evacuated as well, but was told there wasn't time or space in the transports. Instead, Ruger and his HQ sailed for Harstad, where he took command of Norwegian forces fighting around Narvik. German bombers interfered with the evacuation on the 26th of April, reducing Andalsnes to matchwood. Anti-aircraft cruisers and Bittern-class anti-aircraft sloops put up a stream of fire. In addition, Gladiator fighters operating from the frozen surface of Lake Leskjagorg, 30 miles southeast of Andalsnes, and skuas flying from carriers, battled the Luftwaffe until overwhelmed. Thereafter, Glorious and Ark Royal stood off Andalsnes, their aircraft protecting their transports. On three successive nights, the 30th of April to the 2nd of May, the Navy lifted off 5,084 personnel, without the loss of a single man. By this time, Carton de Wiart was evacuating Namsos in the teeth of German air attack. His task was made harder by the Prime Minister's announcement on the 2nd of May that the last Allied troops had left Andalsnes, which helped the Luftwaffe concentrate its activity. Thick fog masked Namsos on the night of the 2nd and 3rd of May, but shortly after dawn, Ju-88s attacked the French destroyer Bisson, scoring a direct hit on her forward magazine, which spectacularly blew up. The Allied destroyer Afridi scooped up survivors. She'd just rejoined the main force when she too was hit, sinking in just 20 minutes. Chasseurs d'Alpin, survivors of the Bisson, found themselves swimming for their lives for a second time in less than 3 hours. That evening, Norwegian forces which had been left behind surrendered to the Germans. Evacuation of central Norway shocked Britain. On the 29th of April, a deputation of peers and MPs, led by Lord Salisbury, formally protested to Lord Halifax about the want of initiative shown by the government in its war policy. The next day, Harold Nicholson, an MP, wrote in his diary, "The general impression is that we may lose the war." On the 3rd of May, General Ironside, the chief of the Imperial General Staff, heard that there is a first-class row commencing in the House. In France, too, Reynaud's government was coming under increasing pressure from the Chamber of Deputies. Chamberlain responded to mounting criticism with a debate on Norway in the House of Commons on the 7th of May. He thought he would survive, but his support proved too small. On the 10th of May, Winston Churchill became Prime Minister. At dawn that day, the Wehrmacht launched its major offensive against the Low Countries and France. As this offensive appeared to conform to Allied expectations, at least at first, and as massive force had been accumulated in northern Norway, Churchill demanded that Narvik be taken. The Allies' superiority was crushing. Against Diefel's 4,000, they had more than 30,000. They had 48 heavy and 60 light anti-aircraft guns. In addition, they had land-based squadrons of Gladiator and Hurricane fighter aircraft, and the aircraft of three carriers to give them air parity, if not air superiority. They had abundant field artillery and squadrons of French Hotchkiss light tanks. In addition, the troops, particularly those of the French Foreign Legion and French and Polish mountain troops, were well-trained regulars. There was an additional imperative to strike. German forces in central Norway, now freed from operations around Namsos and Andalsnes, were moving north, spearheaded by 2nd Mountain Division. Beginning on the 4th of May, the British had landed 5 specially recruited independent companies under the command of Colonel Colin Gubbins on the coast south of Narvik to delay the German advance. Instead, the Germans bypassed the British. In a daring operation on the 10th of May, 2 Dornier flying boats and a commandeered Norwegian steamer, Nord Norge, landed 2 companies of infantry at Hemnesberget, north of the British positions. British warships soon located and sank the Nord Norge, but by that time, her job was done. Battalions of the Irish and Scots Guards were thrown in and succeeded in slowing the progress of 2nd Mountain Division. On the 12th of May, the offensive against Narvik was at last underway. Attacking in overwhelming strength, Norwegian, French and Polish troops eliminated German forces on the Skåneland Peninsula, 30 miles long and about 10 to 15 miles wide, which formed the northern shore of the Ufotfjord and Herjansfjord, the 40-mile channel which linked Narvik to the sea. In London, Churchill was delighted with the preliminary victory. On the 13th of May, the new Minister of War, Anthony Eden, assured the Norwegian ambassador that Allied action in Norway would be pursued with the utmost energy, a commitment which he underscored by replacing Mackesy with Lieutenant General Claude Auchinleck, an expert on mountain warfare on the northwest frontier. But on the 15th of May, the German offensive in France broke through the French front at Sedan, heralding the collapse of the French army, the capitulation of France, and possibly the invasion of the British Isles. Norway had suddenly become an embarrassing distraction. On the 23rd of May, the British War Cabinet decided to evacuate northern Norway. However, in order to salvage some prestige from the wreckage, they decided that before evacuation, Narvik would have to be taken. The attack began at midnight on the 27th of May. Supported by a massive bombardment, the 1st Battalion of the Foreign Legion and a Norwegian battalion crossed the Rombaksfjord to land east of Narvik on Orneset Beach. Here they came under intense fire from a heavily defended hill, codenamed Hill 457. Calling in heavy naval gunfire, the Legionnaires and Norwegians advanced slowly but methodically against German positions. At the same time, a Polish battalion attacked the town of Ankers, a mile to the south of Narvik across the Bisfjord. At 0400, the Luftwaffe arrived, severely damaging the cruiser Cairo, and forced the rest of the task force to make smoke and withdraw down the field. With the sudden disappearance of Allied naval gunfire, the Germans counterattacked, driving the Poles from Ankers and pushing the Legionnaires and Norwegians back down Hill 457. Shortly after 0600, RAF Hurricanes appeared over Narvik, driving off the Luftwaffe. Additional French, Polish and Norwegian units were now fed into the battle. Reduced to about 400 mountain soldiers and sailors, the Germans retreated along the last escape route open to them, the road running eastward along the Bisfjord. On the same day, the 28th of May, Narvik was captured. Belgium surrendered, and the British Expeditionary Force began evacuating through Dunkirk. On the 1st of June, operations to push Dietl's force across the Swedish frontier were suspended, and King Haakon was informed that the British and French were leaving. The king and his government went too. By the 7th of June, the bulk of Anglo-French forces were aboard six large liners, ploughing southwest across the Norwegian Sea. Because of events in France, their escort had been reduced to a heavy cruiser and a flotilla of destroyers. Less than 100 miles away, Scharnhorst, Gneisenau and Admiral Hipper were searching for them. But this time, the Allies were lucky. Instead of the slow, heavily laden convoy, the German battlecruisers found the carrier Glorious, escorted by only two destroyers. Unable to launch her aircraft because of unfavorable sea conditions, Glorious quickly succumbed to German fire, only 35 of her complement of nearly 1,600 surviving. The accompanying destroyers, Ardent and Acasta, put down a smokescreen and then charged from behind it towards the German warships, launching their torpedoes. German gunfire sank both. But a torpedo from the Acasta hit Scharnhorst, sending her limping into Trondheim. For the Royal Navy, the Norwegian campaign had ended as it had begun, almost exactly 2 months earlier, with a chance encounter between British destroyers and major German warship. The German invasion of Norway was the first example in history of a coordinated air, sea and land operation involving all three services. it was to serve as a model for the future. The Germans had been bold and innovative, cancelling out Allied superiority at sea with their own superiority in the air. By contrast, the Allied performance had been inept to the point of criminality. It was not a case of elderly, hidebound British commanders being unable to adjust to a new form of warfare. In fact, it had been the younger British commanders who had failed, while the old warhorses, Carton de Wiart and Lord Cork, had put in performances to match those of the Germans. By the standards of the First World War, the criterion against which the generation who fought in Norway assessed the intensity of fighting, losses had been light. In land operations, the British had lost 1,869 men, either dead, missing, or severely wounded. The French and Poles had lost 530, and the Norwegians 1,335. The Germans had lost a total of 5,296, dead and missing. At sea, losses were about equal, approximately 2,500 sailors apiece, who died on the aircraft carrier, the three cruisers, seven destroyers and four submarines, lost by the Royal Navy, and the three cruisers, 10 destroyers and six submarines, lost by the German Navy. The British, of course, could afford the losses, and the German Navy could not. It was never to appear again in such strength. For the Germans, the most important strategic result was the establishment of naval and air bases north and northeast of the British Isles, from which they could raid British sea lanes and break the British naval blockade. They could also now receive an uninterrupted supply of Swedish iron ore, which rose from 600,000 tons in 1941 to 1.8 million tons by 1943. But the price Germany paid was very heavy. Their success in Norway ensured that Winston Churchill became Britain's leader, and therein lay the seeds of the destruction of the Third Reich.